Hello and welcome. In fact, there's also one more scheduling change, I think. If you look at the printed schedules, one of the talks is swapped between Thursday and Friday, so don't be surprised. And from the important parts of the conference, there's the after party at 6 p.m. So, you know, book your calendars to be there. Okay, so my name is Adam Warski. I work at SoftwareMill. That's the company which organizes this event. So if you would have a praise for the event or if you would have something to complain about, please come to us. So yeah, if there's anything wrong, there are people in blue t-shirts, like over there, which you can always contact and ask for help or tell them how what good time you have. Yeah, so I think that's about it for the organizational part. So, my original idea for the talk was to do kind of an update on our open source Scala ecosystem. As a company, we develop a couple of open source projects in Scala and outside of Scala, but of course here we would focus on Scala mostly. So I want to talk about TAPIRS, STTP, and OX, which is our new project. So if you don't know, STTP is our HTTP client. TAPIRS is a library for describing endpoints, which you can then expose as a server, consume as a client, or document using OpenAPI. But when I did a dry run, it would take about an hour. So that wouldn't work. So I decided to just focus on the newest one, which is OX. But that's not right because it actually has a grammatical error, so that's how you write it in English. So there's a slight change as we will talk mostly about OX. So you might wonder, what is OX? So OX is our prototype concurrency library built on top of Project Loom, so Java 19, 20, and above. It's a prototype, so it's possible that it's total garbage and it's not going to end up being useful. But it's also possible that there are some things that actually might survive and might form some, you know, stable library that you might use in the future. Because it's a prototype, remember to be critical about what you see, and it will be great to hear your feedback, what you think about the various things you will see here. So that's the prototype part. The library itself is based on, as I said, on Java 19, so it requires Loom. What is Loom? I suppose many of you might know. If you don't, Loom brings an asynchronous runtime into Java. So before Loom, whenever you created a thread in Java, this mapped 1-1 to an operating system level thread. And that's an expensive resource, so you couldn't allocate too many threads. And switching threads is expensive, and it's memory consuming, and so on. So what Project Loom does is it bakes into the JVM something that we know from Katz Effect and Zio. So there we have fibers, which are lightweight, which we can switch between very quickly. And we can now do the same in Java. So we can create a lot of virtual threads, how they are called. The API is exactly the same as for a normal thread. So we can create tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands virtual threads, and things should work fine, and things should work in a performant way. So now that we've got this asynchronous runtime baked into the JVM, the question is, can we actually use it somehow to our advantage? So let's try to do that. So I will leave the PDF now, and we will go into IntelliJ. So we will try to look at a couple of examples. So here I've got two methods which simulate doing some hard work. So the first thing to notice is that when you are using Loom, doing thread.sleep is completely fine. If you are using like functional effect systems like Katz Effect or Zio, you are probably allergic to that. You know that you can't do that, right? You can't do any blocking calls. It's completely the opposite in the Loom land. This will if it's run in a virtual thread, it will suspend the virtual thread, and the scheduler will just run another virtual thread without any significant cost, right? So what the scheduler does is it maps a large number of virtual threads into a smaller pool of platform threads. So we have two methods which do some hard work. They simulate doing something, I know, over the network and so on. And what we would like to do is we would like to run these two methods in parallel. So it's a very simple task for a start. And we can do it using the Java API. So apart from the runtime itself, another component of Loom is an API for running a concurrency API built into Java. That's how it looks, more or less, to run these two methods in parallel. So the main, you might wonder, why do we need another API if we have the executor service in Java already? So the key difference here is that this aims to be a structured concurrency API. Okay, so what's structured concurrency? So a structured concurrency is is an approach where the lifetime of the threads is bound to the syntactic structure of the code, hence the name. This approach was pioneered by Python and is also now used in Kotlin and is now adopted by Java. So we might want to explore if we can use it in Scala as well. So the basic idea is that if you have a syntactic block in which you start threads, the moment control steps over that block, you can be sure that any threads created within that block will be finished, right? So we might either wait for these threads to complete normally, we might interrupt them and wait until they finish after being interrupted. So these are various strategies which we might take to actually ensure this property. But if a function satisfies this structural concurrency property, you can be sure that if a block of code exits where you have created some threads, they will be finished. From a more functional programming point of view, you might think of that property as a purity characteristic, right? So you might say that a function satisfies the structural concurrency property if it is pure with respect to threading side effects, right? So this threading, the fact that a function actually starts some threads becomes an implementation detail of that function, right? There are no threads leaking outside. So if you start a function, maybe it starts some threads, maybe not. That's just its way of doing its business. But when it completes, there won't be any threads left behind. So that's the aim of the Java API. So let's look at it a bit closer. So here we create a new scope. So this scope is the syntactic block, which will ensure that any threads actually finish before the scope is closed. So in Java, here we use try finally to close the scope. So this scope.close actually terminates all threads that are left behind. So in Java, we would use try with resources, which would be a bit more compact than this, so it would be one less line. But otherwise, the code is identical in Java as in Scala. So what we do is we create a new scope, we fork two virtual threads, then we wait for these two threads to complete, so we join. We propagate any errors and exceptions if they occurred, and then we can obtain the result. There are some problems with this API. First of all, it is quite low level, and second of all, it is quite fragile. So if you happen to call these methods in the wrong order, you will get a structure violation exception. If you try to call result now before calling join, you will get a null, and probably later you will get an NP. So it's very easy to misuse it, even in a small example, and if we scale to a larger one, it would be even easier to misuse it then. So I think APIs where you have to be cautious to call methods in the right order can be improved upon, and that's what we will try to do, and that's what OXES tries to do. So let's look at a very basic use case of OXES, and we will rewrite the same example using OXES. So we will create a new scope. To do that, we use the scoped method. So that's again the syntactic boundary, which determines the bounds, the lifetime bounds of our threads. So what we will do is we will first fork a first computation, find user. Then we will fork another computation, fetch order, and we will return a result, order.join. Okay, and that's going to be our result. So the result is going to be this tuple, and we will print line, or we can log so that we get the timestamp. By the way, I didn't run this example, so let's first run the Java example, so we will see that it actually works. So let's run it, and you can see that it completed in a bit over a second, so both were sleeping for a second, so they did run concurrently indeed. So that's the Java version. And now let's try to run this the OX version to see that it actually works. And yes, it did run in a bit over a second as well. So what happens here is we create over here, we create a virtual thread. We create another virtual thread over here. And there is no method order that we have to look out for. Then we call join. So this fork, what it returns is a kind of a future-like construct. But it represents a virtual thread running somewhere in the background. You can join it, wait for it to complete and get the value. You can interrupt it and wait for the for its completion. So there's a join and a cancel. These are the two basic methods. And yeah, that's like the basic example of how you can run things in parallel. And there's really no way to get an exception unlike in the Java version. You might wonder how this works. So if we try to fork, let's say we try to extract a method, fork user. If we try to fork outside of the scope, this won't compile. So we'll get an exception. Yeah, there's an error saying that there was no OX found. No OX found. So the way it works is that this scoped method provides an implicit parameter to the block over here. So this is implemented using context functions from Scala 3. So, and this implicit parameter represents the context which we can use to create new threads. So using that, we can actually a bit violate the structural property if we need to. So we can say here that we are using an OX, and this will now work fine. Yeah, it compiled and it ran. So what happens here is that we require this method over here to be used within a concurrency context, if you will, right? So this doesn't really strictly follow the structural concurrency property, but we have a clear marker that this needs to be run within some context which will manage the life cycle of the threads. Okay, so on top of that, OX defines some methods, which you might know from other concurrency libraries. So here, for example, we've got two tasks. The first task sleeps for a second. The second task sleeps for half a second. And we can now race these two tasks. So in a race, we are interested only in the result that completes faster. The other one should be interrupted because we don't want to waste time waiting for it. So what OX defines is a number of race methods where we can provide the tasks to run, and we can print line the result, and we can also wait here. So after we've got the result, we expect the race to be won by task number two, right? So we expect task two to be written here, but we might also sleep to see if task one is indeed interrupted and if it doesn't complete. So let's check it. It worked before, and yeah, it worked now as well. So we can see that indeed it works. What race does is internally it creates a scope. It forks some virtual threads, waits for the first one to complete, and cancels all the others. Right. So it is like an one level higher than the scoped method which we have seen before. One important thing here is that you have to be cautious when you actually run the side effects, right? So over here, if we look, we've got a by name parameter, right? So this ensures that whatever code is given as a parameter will be lazily evaluated. So if you are using functional effect systems, this isn't the case, right? Because we are working in the functional case, we are working with computational descriptions, which are always lazily evaluated. And here we have to ensure that the laziness is appropriately and manually managed, right? So we have, so here we are passing in the lazily evaluated task one, and this is handled by the race result method. But if you're writing your own high-level operators, you have to pay attention to the laziness as well. So that's not something that is a given, unlike in the functional approach. Okay, so that's the concurrency side, the basic concurrency side of OX. So let's see what else we can do. So some of you might probably know the Go programming language. Looking from a programming language theory point of view, it's quite basic, but it did bring to the wider audience one concept, which is that of channels. Channels and CSP are itself a very old thing in computer science, but they've been popularized and brought, you know, to a mainstream programming language first by Go, and that's, I think, one of the few really innovations that Go brings. So let's see if we can implement something channel-like using OX. So we've got a channel. Let's create a channel of a string. And what we can do now is we can create two virtual threads. The first will be sending some hello world from Scalar. We'll be sending some data. And now we can complete the channel. So we can say that the channel is now finished. There will be no more data. So that's the first virtual thread that will be running in the background. And the second one, what we will do is we will loop. So there's a helper method for every while it repeats the given block of code until it, as long as it returns true. So we will iterate over here, and what we will do, we'll receive from the channel. The receive method returns an either, telling us on the left if the channel is complete, so if it completed with an error or with a done, or on the right with a value. So we have too much, and we can say if it's a left channel state error, then we log the error with an E, and we return false. If it's a left, because we are done, we just return false. We don't log anything. And if it's a right value, we log info got this value, and we return true. Okay. And we will assign this to this result of the fork. Again, the result of the fork is this future-like construct, which represents the running virtual thread, and we will wait for that to complete. So such a channel, by default, it has a buffer of size 1. You can make it larger. So these send calls will actually block until there's a matching receive over here. Right? So let's run this and let's see if this basic use case actually works. It does, it completed fine. Okay, so we've got these channels, but so far it's more or less like a queue. Well, a queue which you can complete or complete with an error, but it's nothing more than a queue so far. So let's see how we can improve on that. So next example, we will look at, we will have a channel where we will be sending over strings, and we will fork two processes. We will fork a producer and a consumer, and they will run indefinitely until we finish the code. So the producer, what it does is it will send random strings. So it will send a random string of a random length. Then it will sleep for a random amount of time, and it will call itself recursively. So it's an infinite loop. And we will mark it as a tail recursive so that it's stack save, you can notice that it returns a nothing, which nicely marks the fact that it never actually completes, right? It's never going to return a value. It might throw an exception though. So that's our producer, right? The channel implements two traits. One is a sink, the other one is a source. So here we are narrowing down our interface just to the sync part where we can send. So let's implement the consumer. So the consumer, of course, will receive. But what we want to do is we want to summarize the total length of received strings in the given second, right? So each second we want to output the number of characters that we have received so far. So we will need another source which will tell us that a second has passed. So we will call it the tick source. So there's a happy method for that. Every second we will emit a tick, and not the Kerberos ticket, but a tick. And we will need a case object tick over here, just a value to send. And why doesn't it like that code? Ah, because there's no scope. So we need to run it in a scope. So this tick method, it creates a virtual thread, which actually emits every second, it writes every second to a channel, right? And it returns the source for that channel. And to create this virtual thread, it needs to have, it needs to be run within a concurrency scope, right? So we need to create the scope over here, and this is all checked by the compiler that it's correctly used by the use of the implicit OX parameters. So we've got the tick source. So what we will do now, we will consume from either of these sources. So we will create a helper do consume method, which will accumulate the number of characters received so far. It will also return a nothing. It will also be tail recursive to be stack safe. So now what we need to do is we need to select either from the tick source or from the string source whatever value is available first. And that's also something that is well known from Go. There's the select method where we can select either from the strings or from the ticks. And this also, if we go to the sources, you can see that it takes two sources and it returns either information disclosed or is an either. It's an alias for an either. So it returns either information that the channel is done or completed with an error, or it returns one of those two values, right? So here we are using a sum type from Scala 3. We are returning a T1 or a T2, right? So it's like flattened. Okay, so we select over here. We don't care about the error case. So in case we get, in case all the channels are done, or in case one of them is in an error, we will just throw an exception. So we use the auth-throw helper method. And we now match. We could have received a tick. In that case, we log information, total number of characters received the second is accumulator. And we continue consuming with a zero, right? Or we could have received a string. And then we consume and we add to the accumulator the length of the string. Okay, and what we need to do is we need to kick the things off with a do consume zero. And we have a compilation error, but let's try to run it nevertheless. Maybe it's just an IntelliJ, yeah. And it works, more or less. We don't have the exact data to verify it, but we have to believe it that it actually works. Okay, so the select method is something that makes channels distinct from queues, right? There is no operation on a number of queues that you can actually take one and leave all the others intact, and that's what the select does, right? It takes exactly one element from one of the provided sources and leaves the others intact. However, if you've been working with reactive streams, with Akka streams, FS2, or the kind, you probably are used to working with high-order functions using .map, .filter on streams, and so on. And this is often very convenient. And that's something that we also can do over here. So what we can do is we can take a source, and we can map over that source. So let's create a length source. We will take the string's source and we will map over it to obtain the length of the string. And now this will be a source of ints, right? Because we have mapped over the string source and we have extracted the length. And we can now, length, it's like this, right? We can now use that over here. And so here we will now get an int. And so we can just use that int over here. And it should still work. Let's see. It should still compile. If it compiles, it works. Yeah. And we get the report every second. So again, how this works, this dot map, it does require the concurrency context over here, right? So apart from taking a function, the mapping function, the capacity of the resulting channel, it also needs to be run within a concurrency context. What it does is it creates a new virtual thread which consumes data from the strings source and produces data to a new channel. And the data is the data that's produced is transformed using the given function. So one thing that is important here is, again, if you've been working with functional streams, this will be different. Because in the functional streams, you might do something like this, right? You want to select from strings mapped from length and the tick. This won't actually work that well, because now every time we invoke the select, we would create a new virtual thread and a new channel consuming from the strings source. And that's not something that we want to do, right? We want to create only a single thread which actually performs the mapping, and then we want to consume from the mapped source. So here, everything is eager, right? Eagerly evaluated. The moment we call dot map, this virtual thread will start transforming the data. In a functional streams library, this is done lazily, right? We first create the description of the transformation that we want to run, and only then we can run it, and the executor will actually take care of running our stream computation. Okay, and the final example that I wanted to show, it's not yet written, so yeah, let's go over here, is how else we can transform this stream. So we will again create a scope, and we will create a channel of ints, and we will fork a thread which will produce consecutive numbers onto that string. It's again will never complete, and c.send n, and then we produce n plus 1, and we have to kick things off using produce 0, right? So this is safe to do. It won't like overflow the buffer or anything, because the send is blocking. It will wait until there is space in the buffer. So what we can do now, we've got a channel of ints, so maybe, you know, we want to map over it twice. But mapping it over it twice, so if we would do c.map.map, this would actually create two virtual threads and two channels, like two intermediate channels, passing the data one from another. So that might be excessive and wasteful. So what we can do is we can fuse some transformations together. So we can use the transform method, and here we get an iterator. We get an iterator. That iterator is backed by our source, and the whatever transformation we do on the iterator, it will be run in a single virtual thread. So what we can do here is we can filter only even numbers, then we can add one, and we can take the 10 first ones, and in the end, so this whole transformation will be run in a single virtual thread, and then we can consume things using a for each and to string, and now we can say that we are done, and let's see if this works. Yeah, it's more or less what we expected. So what we will create here is this transform will create a single virtual thread running this transformation over here. It's like fused into a single asynchronous computation step, if you will. And this will create another virtual thread which will actually consume all the data. And it will block until all until the stream is done. It is done because we take 10 here, right? If we wouldn't do that, the stream would be infinite. Okay, so that's what's in OX currently. So there's still a lot to do. First of all, the performance is unknown, and nobody checked it. I don't think we've managed to break virtual threads too much, so the scoped fork things are probably fine. I'm not sure about channels. Channels, there's some, you know, atomics that are being used, some concurrent queues, so the performance might be so-so, it might be good, I don't know. There's a question, that more like a resource question, let's say, about error propagation. So in the Scala, in the Java variant of the API, you might have noticed that we have created a certain scope implementation. And in Java, we have different scope implementations for different use cases, like if you want to run things in parallel, if you want to raise things, and so on. In OX, that's done differently. We've got different types of fork method. So we can, within one scope, we can either fork things in a way that if the fork completes with an exception, it will interrupt the main scope and it will propagate the error. So it's going to be do like a fail fast, and that's the default behavior. Or we can fork, retaining the error inside inside the returned value, so we can inspect it later, but it won't impact the overall scope. So the error propagation is something that we have to look at. There's also the question of error handling, right? We don't have a good mechanism for error handling yet. The channel.receive, for example, returns an either. So you know, it's a you might either return an either, or you might throw an exception, and both choices have their pros and cons. An either like forces you to actually consume and act on the error, right? It's a bit like in Go as well, where you have to always inspect the one of the two return values. But in a more type-safe way. Or you can throw an exception, which maybe you would play nicer with the Java philosophy. But then exceptions have some performance penalty if you construct these exceptions often. Another thing is that we don't really have a good mechanism to signal to the developer that that method actually runs side effects, right? With functional effects, we can do that because we've got our IOs, which you can, if you see a function returning an I/O, you know that it actually runs some side effects, and you expect, you know that you have to handle errors differently, right? Because there might be intermittent errors, there might be timeouts, and so on. So here we don't have that mechanism. Scala has a prototype of checked exceptions, but it's still something to investigate. Yeah, and the whole streaming approach is also something to validate. So if you would have some thoughts on this, it's like today and tomorrow is a perfect place to discuss them, or you know, just write on our community forum. And I would, just to sum up, I would like to do a very quick comparison between some of the traits of the functional effect systems and OX. So in a functional effect system, I think the main downside that people often cite is that there's a high syntax overhead, right? Because when you work with cuts effect or Zio, you have to work with monads, you have to use flat maps to combine computations. You cannot use the control flow constructs that you are used to, so you cannot use ifs, for loops, whiles, and so on to combine these computations. So these are these systems, because of this, have quite a high barrier of entry, and you have to grow used to this new syntax. But otherwise, they're really great, right? They are type safe, you get fearless refactoring because there's referential transparency, so we can just extract computations as a value. We've got great failure management, meaning that we can, especially in Zio, where we have the dedicated error channel, we can actually distinguish between computations which cannot fail and computations which can fail in a certain way. Zio also has separate effect channel error channels for for expected exceptions, like things that might happen because a database is down, and a separate one for defects. So this is handled really nicely. We can run controlled testing. So because there's a custom runtime in these systems, we can in our tests, we can simulate the flow of time. So if we have any time-dependent tests, they're usually very flaky because, you know, if you do a thread sleep and you wait on something, then the CPU is busy in this test run and the test will fail, and the next time it will run fine. So here we can actually control the flow of time, right? Because we have a custom runtime where we can implement this. So not only our tests can be less flaky, but they also can run quicker because we don't need to have this this buffer waiting for things that we are sure that they will happen in this second, right? And interruption is also well implemented, again, with a, usually with a separate error channel. Now with Loom and with a Loom-based library like OX, we don't get the syntax overhead, right? Because we can just use direct syntax as we are used to. We can use more like an imperative style or procedural style. So that's nice. We can use the control flow methods that we are used to. So it's easier to read from the syntactic side, but we don't get some of the other traits, right? We don't get the controlled testing. We don't get the fearless refactoring. Failure management is an unknown, so we know maybe Scala's checked exceptions, maybe not. Interruption is inherited with Java's problems, so interruption is implemented using an exception, which can always be caught and ignored. The effect representation in functional systems, it's always lazy, it's uniform. Here we have to manually make sure that we don't run things too early. So, you know, it's a trade-off. The main question is how much bothered are you with the syntax overhead and how much concurrency you actually have in your system, right? If it's a mostly concurrent system, maybe the traits of the functional effect systems will be more important. If it's a system where concurrency appears not so often, maybe systems written using this approach will actually be easier to maintain. But that's still a research question, and you know, feedback is most welcome. And when talking about feedback, just finishing, I would like to do a quick plug for STTP because we have released the first milestone of the fourth version of STTP client. It should say STTP client, not STTP simply, where we focus on simplifying the user experience of actually using an HTTP client. So if you would have any other ideas for the breaking changes that we can do, because now it's a great moment, if there's something that annoys you in STTP that you think should be easier, if you have any, you know, rules of thumb, how to avoid some bugs, let us know. And we have a community forum for that, both for STTP, Tapir, and OX. So if you would have any ideas about OX, that's also a great place to write about it. I would be happy to listen to it. You know, if you just want to complain or just write why it doesn't work, that's fine as well. I can't promise that we will fix everything, but it's always good to know your opinions. Okay, and with that, yeah, I would like to thank SoftwareMill, of course, who is sponsoring all of this work. So if you would be ever in need of any software development, you know where to look for us. And yeah, with that, I think I would like to finish. I'm on Twitter and Mastodon. So yeah, thank you, and I hope you will have a great time at Scalar.
Thank you for that. I think we have like 5 minutes for some Q&A, maybe. Are there any questions?
We've got 25 seconds.
No, we're going to manage it.
It's an authoritative clock.
Okay, do you have any questions to Adam? Don't be so shy early in the morning. Okay, there is a question.
Hey Adam, hey. What license do you foresee for OX?
License?
Yeah.
It's Apache 2.
Okay, good to know, right? You won't back down of it. always Apache 2?
Sorry, yeah, everything is Apache 2, if that's your question. Yeah.
Okay, good to know.
Okay, anybody else?
So you can fork it if you'd like, which is a very ox.
Okay, we have a question here. I'm going to get with the microphone here.
Hi, Adam. Thank you for the talk.
Thank you.
Really nice. I have a quick question. Have you had any occasion to test some kind of interoperability with future, some interaction with future, since you know they're already in the standard library.
And
the OX, mm-hmm. given it's really similar to execution context. So yeah, I had to ask it.
Right, of course. Yeah, that's a very good question. So as far as futures are concerned, I think in a Loom world, what we will need is we will need a .get method on a future, right? So you will want to have a way to actually block on a future to wait for it to complete. We can do now the await.result, but you need to provide the time bound and so on. So I think to integrate nicely, even if it's an extension method, you will need to do a .get. And futures themselves, they can run on an execution context that is backed by virtual threads. So this just works. That's not a problem. There's, for example, a TAPIR version which runs on Loom, and there's a Netty TAPIR Netty server which runs on Loom, and it runs just fine. It just uses virtual threads instead of normal threads for futures, and yeah, that's not a problem. So the only thing, the integration point would be the .get method, I think. So it's very similar to the join that we have seen on the result returned by forking a virtual thread, right?